Welcome everyone to the very first multi-church worship combining Orange and LA County Unitarian Universalist Churches. I am the Reverend Sean Wilshire serving Orange Coast Unitarian Universalist Church, and I am delighted to welcome you along with the Reverends Jason, Lee Marie, Lissa, Rika, Kent, and Steve. And today we have a wonderful worship service for you, including music by our many gifted music leaders. And even our children came together for a story, thanks to the directors of religious education. As you can see, it's been a wonderfully collaborative effort, and it's exciting to see just what we can all do together. Let's just take a moment to respectfully recognize that all of our church properties rest on Ahoshiman and Tongva land. Now, by way of welcome, I'd like to invite you, all of you haven't already, to open the chat box this morning and to say good morning. And you might say which church you normally attend, to just welcome everyone here. Now, I want to extend a very special welcome to visitors. You have come at a really cool service where seven different congregations from around Southern California have come together to worship. And if you're seeking a spiritual home, we hope that you will reach out to the congregation nearest you and join them next week for their regular service. As Unitarian Universalists, we are bound together not by a common set of rules or beliefs, but really a covenant is what binds us. A covenant is simply a promise that whatever our beliefs, we accept one another and encourage each other in spiritual growth. We affirm that all life has inherent value and that all existence is interconnected. We strive for justice and compassion in our deeds and relationships, being committed to creating a welcoming community without regard to those traits that sometimes divide people. Now, after this service, we'll be placing everyone who remains who would like to into Zoom breakout rooms for about 20 minutes of social time. You don't need to go to another link, just stay here. And everyone is welcome to join in. It's going to be a great way to get to know all these amazing, wonderful Unitarian Universalists. So as you, most of you know, our worship begins with the lighting of our chalice, the symbol of the Unitarian Universalist tradition. And this morning, we're going to be singing a song with David. Let us sing.
From the chalice comes the flame that glimmers in the night. Glows throughout the day in a blaze of inner light. Shine through the storm, sparkle in the rain, illuminate our world, the chalice and the flame.
Love's ocean tide coming in and going out between the purple midnight sky sparkling with stars and the hand of my grandmother brushing our new puppy's fur with her own pink hairbrush. Love yourself, the waters chant, but nobody ever gave you the map to quite get there. Creased and worn, your family used to drive to the sea by that map. Was that where love lives? At the shoreline, at the end of a long trip? Love others, the waters chant. Those aunts who fed you and showed you old movies and school librarians who ate their lunches with you and spouses who rescued you when you were drowning. Do they feel your love or do you scatter raindrops onto a raging sea? Love your enemies. The waters say to the ones who look at you sideways, who say you don't measure up, who storm buildings and speak a blasphemy of curses of those in need. Is there love for them without drawing from the waters of condescension? Oh, waves of love, how can we brew you strong tea and sit with you? How can you be a tidal wave that revolutionizes the world, that splashes new stars onto an ancient sky and strokes the puppy's fur and sails us outward from the selfishness within? But what if all we had to do is let this elusive but persistent wave wash into our lives, letting it make this world's sky not an old backdrop for the same tired drizzle, but the brilliant blank beach canvas upon which we splash a new ocean, our revolutionary ocean, our revolution of love.
Broken hearts everywhere, from stepping on them we don't care. Somebody tell me what we gonna do. Even though it's plenty to share, people hungry on the street, it ain't fair. But you don't think about it till it's you. Now I'm gonna say how I feel, and what I wanna say is love's the only thing that's real. I won't tell you what to do, but just believe that love, the only thing we have that's true. 'Cause love is the answer.
It's the answer.
It's the answer to the questions in your mind. I say it's love is the answer.
It's the answer.
It's the answer. If you're looking, you will find.
The answer is love.
Yes, it is.
The answer is love.
Say it again.
The answer is love.
I'm telling you now.
The answer is love.
Friends nowhere to be found to help you when you are down. But you know you're the one to blame. You know what's wrong from what's right. Nobody wins a fight, but still we play the game. I'm gonna say how I feel, and what I wanna say is love's the only thing that's real. I won't tell you what to do, just believe that love, the only thing that's real and true. 'Cause love is the answer.
It's the answer.
It's the answer to the questions in your mind. Say is love is the answer.
It's the answer.
If you're looking, it's the answer you gon' find. Love is the answer.
It's the answer.
It's the only thing that everybody needs. I say is love is the answer.
It's the answer.
It's the only thing that makes us truly free.
The answer is love. 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 The answer is love.
Our story is Good Morning Neighbor by David Colley and Maria Dick.
A mouse wanted to make an omelet. To make an omelet, the mouse needed an egg, but he didn't have one. So he thought, I'll go and ask my neighbor, the blackbird. Good morning, neighbor. Do you have an egg that I could use to make an omelet?
I'm sorry, I don't, said the blackbird, but I do have flour. With an egg, we can make a cake. Let's go and ask my neighbor, the dormouse.
A mouse and a blackbird wanted to make a cake.
Good morning, neighbor. Do you have an egg that we could use to make a cake? I'm sorry, I don't, said the dormouse, but I do have butter. You'll need butter to make a cake. For the egg, we can ask my neighbor, the mole.
A mouse, a blackbird, and a dormouse wanted to make a cake.
Good morning, neighbor. Do you have an egg that we could use to make a cake? I'm sorry, I don't, said the mole. But I do have sugar. You'll definitely need sugar to make a cake. Perhaps my neighbor the hedgehog will loan us an egg.
A mouse, a blackbird, a dormouse, and a mole wanted to make a cake.
Good morning, neighbor. Do you have an egg that we could use to bake a cake?
I'm sorry, I don't, said the hedgehog. What kind of cake do you want to make? I have apples. Maybe we can make an apple cake. My neighbor, the raccoon, might have an egg.
A mouse, a blackbird, a dormouse, a mole, and a hedgehog all wanted to make a cake.
Good morning, neighbor. Do you have an egg that we could use to make a cake?
I'm sorry, I don't, said the raccoon, but I have cinnamon to add flavor. Let's go see if my neighbor, the lizard, has an egg.
A mouse, a blackbird, a dormouse, a mole, a hedgehog, and a raccoon wanted to make a cake.
Good morning, neighbor. Do you have an egg that we could use to make a cake?
I'm sorry, I don't, said the lizard, but I do have raisins. For the egg, we can ask my neighbor, the bat.
A mouse, a blackbird, a dormouse, a mole, a hedgehog, a raccoon, and a lizard wanted to make a cake. They already had flour, butter, sugar, apples, cinnamon, and raisins.
The only thing missing was the egg.
An egg, said the bat. The neighbors finally had all the ingredients they needed, and so they began.
The blackbird poured the flour, the bat broke the eggs, the dormouse added the butter, and the mole stirred in the sugar. The mouse mixed the dough, then the hedgehog added the apples. The raccoon sprinkled the cinnamon and the lizard topped it with raisins.
All we need now is an oven. Let's ask our neighbor the owl, said the lizard.
A blackbird, a dormouse, a mole, a hedgehog, a raccoon, a lizard, and a bat wanted to make a cake.
The cake was ready to be baked. All they needed was an oven.
Good morning, neighbor. Could we use your oven to bake a cake?
Certainly, said the owl. So all of the animals joined the owl in her kitchen. The cake finally came out of the oven, and it was perfect. But when it was time to serve it, the owl asked, "How many slices should I cut?"
The blackbird put in the flour so she gets a slice. The dormouse put in the butter so he gets a slice. The mole offered the sugar, so obviously she gets a slice. The hedgehog provided the apples, so he gets a slice too. A slice also goes to the raccoon for adding the cinnamon, and a slice goes to the lizard for pitching in the raisins. Lastly, a slice goes to the bat for putting in the egg. And we must not forget a slice for the owl for the use of her oven.
What about me? Asked the mouse. You didn't put in anything, said the dormouse, so you don't get a slice. And anyways, it's hard to cut a cake into 9 slices.
The mouse went away sadly while the other animals began to divide the cake.
Well, said the blackbird, if the mouse hadn't asked me for an egg, I wouldn't have thought about giving him flour to make the cake.
If he hadn't asked me for an egg, I wouldn't have put in the butter so said the door's mouse.
And I wouldn't have offered the sugar, said the mole.
And I wouldn't have pitched in the apple, said the hedgehog.
And I wouldn't have added the cinnamon, said the raccoon.
And I wouldn't have pitched in the raisins, ow, said the lizard.
And we wouldn't have a cake to share, said the bat.
You're right, said the owl. And so the blackbird, the dormouse, the mole, the hedgehog, the raccoon, the lizard, the bat, and the owl cut the cake into 9 slices.
Which wasn't that horrid after all.
The end!
The end. Bye-bye!
Let us enter into a spirit of meditation, prayer, or reflection, each according to our own practices. Take a deep breath in and let it out long. If you like, place your feet on the floor to ground yourself to Mother Earth, or sit in any way in which you are comfortable. Close your eyes now or gaze softly. Breathing in and breathing out your own natural breath. Allow your shoulders to drop. Yes, if you let your shoulders drop gently, your whole body will begin to relax. Let your shoulders drop a little more. If you place your tongue up against your upper teeth and allow your jaw to relax, then let your eyes soften. Your whole face will soften. Keeping your eyes closed, think of a person close to you who loves you very much. It could be someone from the past or present, someone still in your life or someone who has passed. It could be a spiritual teacher or guide. Imagine that person is sending you wishes for your safety, for your well-being, and for your happiness. Feel the warm wishes and love coming from that person towards you. Now repeating silently your warm wishes and love to them. May you live with ease. May you be happy. May you be free from pain. May your life be filled with happiness, health, and well-being. Now imagine that you are surrounded on all sides by all the people who love you and have loved you. Picture all of those friends and loved ones surrounding you in a circle. They are sending their wishes for your happiness, for your well-being, and your health. Bask in their warm wishes and the love coming in from all sides. You are filled and overflowing with warmth and love. Now repeating silently your warm wishes to all of them. May you live with ease. May you be happy. May you be filled with pain, free from pain. May your life be filled with happiness, health, and well-being. Now think of an acquaintance, someone you don't know very well, toward whom you don't have any particular feeling. Could be a neighbor or a colleague or someone you just see around town, but you don't know very well. Like you, this person wishes to experience joy and well-meaning in their lives. Now repeating silently your warm wishes and love to them. May you live with ease. May you be happy. May you be free from pain. May your life be filled with happiness, health, and well-being. Now expand your awareness and picture the whole globe as a tiny little ball. Send wishes to all living beings on the globe who, like you, all of us want to be happy. Now repeating silently your warm wishes and love to them. May you live with ease. May you be happy. May you be free from pain. May your life be filled with happiness, health, and well-being. As we breathe in and out together, imagine our universe unified desire for a revolutionary love, a love for us, a love for those we love and for those who we do not know very well, even those who might be our opponents. All people, all over the world, every one of us who wishes to love, to be loved, to live in ease, to be free of pain, enjoying our lives of happiness and health and well-being. Let's now just rest for a few moments in these thoughts, knowing that we are loved, each of us, right here and right now, just the way we are.
Join me. May I be filled with loving kindness. May I be well. May I be filled with loving
morning, everyone. My name is Lissa. I'm the settled minister at UUCLB, and I'm so glad to be joining all of us today. What an incredible experience of joining. We have 428 screens signed on right now. It's just amazing to be together. And maybe this is one little silver lining that we keep finding in this time of distance, is that we get to join together. And this is exciting for ministers too and music directors, because we don't always get to share and to experience each other's inspiration and wisdom. So I'm just glad to be a part of this, and thank you to everyone who has shared already and to who helped put this together. It's been a great experience of collaboration. So the title of our service today is Revolutionary Love. And one of the inspirations for today, just to ground us a little bit, is in the words and inspiration of Valerie Carr, who's an activist and author. She had a powerful TED Talk entitled Revolutionary Love that informed her new book, which I encourage you to check out. It's called See No Strangers, A Manifesto and Memoir of Revolutionary Love. And Valerie is a part of a movement of progressive religious leaders who've been coming together for the past 15 or so years to exchange ideas and build power at a conference called Revolutionary Love, held at the Middle Collegiate Church in New York City. And she also recently curated an inspirational series called The People's Inauguration, which I encourage you to also check out, bringing together some of those religious leaders and political activists to build this progressive religious movement that is grounded in a revolutionary love. And so as we gather together this morning, over 400 of us Unitarian Universalists, let's remember that we are connected to a larger movement of progressive religious people and spiritual seekers, and that we are diverse in our beliefs, but we're united in this call to build beloved communities in the spirit of a love that is so big, so bold, so inclusive, so world-changing, that it can only be called revolutionary. This is the kind of love which transcends denominations and divisions, the kind of love that breaks open and transforms our hearts and spills out into the world. And so today, my first homily is to share about that love that we bring to ourselves, that revolutionary love of self-care, self-love. So as Unitarian Universalists, we are all about the first principle, honoring the inherent worth and dignity of every person. And that means honoring your own inherent worth and dignity. Loving yourself as the starting point should be easy, right? Well, not exactly. And if we're honest, many of us might admit that we struggle with this one. The truth is that loving ourselves just as we are, flaws, mistakes, and all, deeply, truly, unconditionally, authentically loving ourselves, this is a lifelong process of self-acceptance, forgiveness, and compassion. Loving ourselves is not a destination or achievement we can easily claim. Loving ourselves is something we have to continually practice through all the transitions in our lives as we grow and change and age, and we come to terms with our patterns, our traumas, and where we have been in our lives and where we want to go, the kind of relationship we want to have with ourselves and others. One of my favorite spiritual teachers is Buddhist Sharon Salzberg, and her book, Real Love, The Art of Mindful Communication, I'm sorry, The Art of Mindful Connection, explores that spiritual practice that Lee Marie and our hymn, May I Be Filled with Loving Kindness. This is the loving kindness meditation that grounds Sharon Salzberg's practice and this wonderful book, Real Love. And that practice is about sending loving energy to ourselves, to people we love, and to people we struggle with, our adversaries, our opponents, our people we're in conflict with, who we find we have difficult relationships. And so in Sharon's teaching, for the dozens of years she's been engaged in this practice and teaching this practice, the part of the practice she's found most difficult for her students and for herself is that piece of sending loving kindness to ourselves. That is the one that's most difficult, to love ourselves and to practice bathing ourselves in that loving energy that comes from within. She writes, why is it so difficult to love ourselves? Why is it so much harder to offer ourselves the same sort of care and kindness we readily dispense to our friends? For one thing, the notion of loving oneself has gotten an undeservedly bad rap, which goes something like this. Self-love is narcissism, selfish, self-indulgent, the supreme deliciousness of a runaway ego looking for only number one. In fact, just the opposite is true, she writes. When the airplane cabin pressure is dropping, no one would call it selfish or narcissistic when a father secures his own oxygen mask before turning to help his child. All of us have made mistakes, she writes, and some of those mistakes have been consequential. but we can always find a way to relate to our mistakes with kindness. No matter what troubles have befallen you or what difficulties you have caused for yourself or for others, with love for yourself, you can change, grow, make amends, and learn. Real love, she writes, is not about letting yourself off the hook. It does not encourage you to deny or ignore your problems or deny your mistakes and imperfections. Real love means you see them clearly and still opt to love yourself. So today, I invite you to practice that love, that loving kindness directed to yourself. And let's start right now. Just as Lee Marie and Beth invited us into that loving kindness meditation, let's take that just one step deeper. And so touch your hand to your heart or to your belly, or give yourself a hug and just feel your arms around your shoulders. Breathe in and breathe out. Acknowledge your own struggles, your passions, your joys, your longings. Acknowledge where you're at in your own life journey, always changing. Feel how much you long to be loved and to love. And maybe feel your heart softening. Feel that warmth radiating out from your heart through every part of your body, bathing you in love. And if you can't feel love for yourself today, today is a particularly hard day, just allow the love coming from your community, the love that I'm sending you and all of these people, over 400 people sending you love. Allow that to lift you up, to bolster you, and let you know that you are not alone. Know that you are worthy, and know that you are loved. Amen, and blessed be.
As Unitarian Universalists, Our mandate is to love everyone. You don't have to like them, just love them. Now, people often ask in our churches, but what about terrorists? What about white supremacists? What about Nazis? And when I hear them, I think to myself, man, all those you use doubting if they can actually truly love Nazis and white supremacists, they are all much better you use than I am. I don't even know if I really love that random dude at the bus station. I mean, yes, he probably has inherent worth and dignity, and that makes him worthy of love on this large abstract level. But on the micro level, the me and him level, can I honestly say that I love him? On that level, love seems awfully personal, and I don't even know that dude. But if love only applies on this love, on this lofty, abstract, inherent worth and dignity level, but doesn't translate into my personal life, what is it good for? Now, one thing to know about me is I love the TV show Doctor Who. Love it, absolutely love it. And through watching Doctor Who, I managed to solve this love conundrum for myself. I developed my very own TARDIS theology. Now, in case you're not a Doctor Who fan, which is okay, you still have inherent worth and dignity, let me explain what the TARDIS is. The TARDIS is both a time machine and a spacecraft that looks like a 1960s London police box. It's what Doctor Who travels in. Now, what makes the TARDIS so instrumental for my love conundrum? It is bigger on the inside. Much bigger. From the outside, it is this small, plain-looking police box, but on the inside, it is magnificent. And here is the thing. We are the same. People are like the TARDIS. Every single person we meet is bigger on the inside. On the outside, we're walking around in our human bodies, consciously or unconsciously communicating small tidbits of our identity. And those tidbits make it easier for those we encounter to put it into this box or that box. Boxes that seem to communicate whether we like or we don't like that person, whether they're like us or whether they're not like us. But on the inside, we are unboxed. We contain multitudes. We are magnificent, every single one of us. In fact, we are so magnificent that we contain something to love for everyone we meet. And in reverse, everyone we meet contains something for us to love. We don't even have to like them to find something to love. It may be a characteristic, someone being really calm and organized in moments of chaos and conflict, or someone having a wicked sense of humor. Or it may be a skill set. We may marvel at the fact that they can fix literally anything, or that they actually do cook their way straight into our hearts. But more often than not, that which turns somebody from a box of assumed identities into a real lovable person is their set of experiences and challenges. It is often that once we learn about their lives, their experience or their experiences or their ongoing struggles, that our empathy is activated and somehow we tune in. We may not have had the exact same experience, so we may not sing the exact same tune, but on this deeply human level, we recognize the emotions, fear, loss, love, and we start to harmonize. And this is what unlocks the love. how do we get there? Actually get there with people like that random dude at the bus station? I think it starts with listening deeply, even to strangers. I've had a lot of visitors from Germany who had the most amazing moments of connection in the US simply because they took the question, how are you? Not as a greeting phrase, but as a serious question and actually answered it in great detail. And doing so, they created tiny bubbles of love with strangers. Back to the random dude at the bus station though. Maybe it is true that if we started talking, if there's deep listening, we would find something to marvel at. And if empathy is activated and the harmonizing begins, love will flow. The problem remains though, that I could not ever talk to all the random people all the time. I am an introvert. Too much talking to too many people will definitely not make my love flow. And also, nobody, not even the extroverts, has time for that. But this is why I call it my hardest theology. There is a small leap of faith involved. The simple faith that every single person truly is bigger on the inside. I don't actually know what the random dude at the bus station is going through or what pain he has dealt with in his life. But I assume it's something, and that is enough for me to empathize. And I don't know what universes he contains. I don't know what about him specifically is lovable, but I assume it's something, and that is enough for me too. It's enough to say that I have love in my heart for everyone I meet, everyone I could potentially ever meet, even if I don't quite know yet why. Valerie Carr speaks about this in her TED Talk on revolutionary love, which I agree with Reverend Lissa. If you want to find out more about this amazing project, that's a really good starting point. She says, in order to love others, see no stranger. And when we see no stranger, what we say is, you are a part of me that I don't yet know. I choose to wonder about you. I will listen for your stories and I will pick up a sword for you when you are in harm's way. If we can believe that everyone has inherent worth and dignity on this objective level, then we can also believe that subjectively, everyone contains parts that makes them lovable. What about the Nazis though? The white supremacists and the terrorists? What about the people who actively set out to harm us or those others we have come to love? Well, Reverend Kent is going to talk about loving our adversaries, but I do feel that if we are open to actually really loving others, even if they are different from us, even if we initially put them into boxes we may not usually want to unbox, then maybe we realize that not all others are adversaries. And maybe with this distinction, this large gray group of others who we can love without always having to like them grows. And maybe the group of adversaries shrinks. And maybe that in and of itself would make the world a more loving place.
Dying and being reborn. I see what is and I see what could be. Can't close my eyes again and go back to tide. How can I change our course? I'm just a lonely voice. Wish I could lose myself and all the noise. But if we all would rise, a generation proud, then with a mighty song, we could turn this love around, around.
Though our days with blessed unrest and my nights with dreams of justice, for the turning of the tide. Fill my days with blessed unrest and my nights with dreams of justice. Make me a vessel for the turning of the tide. Ancestors all behind,
I can't proceed with my homily without saying thank you to all our amazing musicians today. It's great to be with so many of you, bringing together so much talent today. So I've preached several sermons on the idea of loving our adversaries over the years. It's usually something about Gandhi or Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. or Satyagraha, our beloved community. And that abstract question is quite a bit more comfortable than talking about my own ability to love an adversary. So I wanted to dig a little deeper this week. In 2018, in Lake Forest, a young man named Blaze Bernstein was murdered in a hate crime. Some of you are familiar with this story. I know those of you at Tapestry are. The murder occurred not far from where I lived at the time. Blaze was stabbed 20 times and his body was left in the bushes in a park. Blaze was both gay and Jewish. The young man who killed him hated both. Blaze and the murderer were in their early 20s at the time and had attended high school together. The murder shook me deeply. It's obviously still in my head and my heart, or I wouldn't be talking about it with you today. As a gay man, I identify with Blaze. The proximity to my home was a stark reminder that unspeakable hatred is just a stone's throw away. How could I find love for this adversary? As I sat down to write, I realized I didn't know much about him other than this one horrible act. So I got curious and I did a little research. I learned that the murderer is a member of a neo-Nazi terrorist group, Adam Waffen Division. It started in the South in 2015 and spread across the United States and to several European countries. Adam Waffen advocates attacks on the US federal government, attacks on people of color, LGBT people, and Jewish people. It's engaged in several plots for mass murder, different plans to cripple the public water system and to destroy parts of the power grid. Since 2017, the organization has been linked to 8 killings in the United States and several brutally violent hate crimes. And this very small group of people, around 50 of them, aims to violently overthrow the US federal government. There's a lot more information available, but that's enough. That is more than enough. That is what I needed to hear in order to understand. By his membership in this group, I can understand that the young man who murdered Blaze Bernstein is disconnected from reality. Somehow, somewhere, his moral compass was shattered. To be honest, I don't know if I'm fully committed to loving my adversary, but I am committed to remembering that they're real life human beings, not monsters. Trauma, fear, mental illness, addiction, neglect, abuse, all can lead to terrible things in the human mind. We humans are all capable of terrible things under the right circumstances. The man who murdered Blaze is in jail right now, awaiting a trial. Until I learned more about his brokenness, his impending life sentence gave me a sense of satisfaction, something akin to revenge, I have to admit. But this week, as I got curious and learned more about him, something shifted. I can't say that I love him, but I can see him as a broken person. A human being, a mother's son. I can't say that I love him yet, but I can imagine that one day I could. This piece of radical love, learning to love our adversaries, didn't seem so daunting when I picked it as the topic, but it's a huge undertaking. And there are plenty of messages about why we should love. Coming to love our adversaries, though, is not going to occur out of sheer willpower. Love does not emerge as the fruit of guilt from a religious tradition or an ethic that tells us that we should love. Loving our adversaries requires a whole lot of tending to our own hearts. At Tapestry, our monthly theme in worship in January was desolation and consolation. So we've been talking about the work involved in healing and strengthening our spirit. When I think of the work of loving our adversaries, here are a few of the pieces of work that come to mind. One is unplugging from the outrage culture of social media and confronting our own anger to know the fear and the sadness that sit behind that anger. Most times, healing requires acknowledging the trauma from our past that this adversary reminds us of. Healing takes intentional, regular practices of self-care and spiritual grounding, and building a community of support. And as Lissa was saying, perhaps most of all, healing involves finding enough self-love and confidence to know that our adversary's words and deeds, however wretched they may be, can never diminish our own inherent worth and dignity. Now, this is a ridiculous amount of work. It's no wonder loving our adversary seems so daunting, but if loving your adversary is your calling, if you have decided, like Dr. King, to stick with love because hate is too great a burden to bear, if you want to take this journey, then get curious about that person that you think is so different from yourself. And even more important, start with healing yourself. And yes, if you're paying attention, you'll notice that we leave off where we started. Loving ourselves, loving our neighbors, loving our adversaries. It's all part of the same puzzle. It's not easy work, but it is our work. Amen.
Of the Spirit, faith, hope, and love abound, and so every soul is blessed and made whole. The truth in our hearts is our God. We are answering the call of love, hands joined together as hearts beat as one. By faith, we dare to proclaim, we are answering the call of love. Sometimes we build a barrier to keep love tightly bound. Together as hearts beat as one. Emboldened by faith, we dare to proclaim, we are answering the call of love. We are answering the call of love.
This is how we clap in our church. So if you've been a Unitarian Universalist in this area for a while, then you know of the awesomeness that is Camp de Benneville Pines. And between the fires and being closed because of the pandemic, they've been hit hard financially in a big way. It will take a revolutionary kind of love and generosity to save them. And so we are appealing to you today. If you can give, please do so. I'll put a link in the chat as well. And you can also find information on their website. But before I do, here is Janet James, the camp's director, to tell you more about it. Thank you for your generosity.
Hello, everyone. This is Janet James, director of Camp de Benneville Pines, coming to you from a wintry mountaintop. Thank you for inviting me to speak to you about camp and the financial challenges we are facing. As you drive into camp from Jinx Lake Road, the forest and camp look absolutely perfect. But upon glancing up to the mountain peaks above camp, one sees nothing but charcoal, ash, and burned out trees. Since everything above camp was burned in the El Dorado fire, our initial flood and mud flow mitigation efforts have gone into installing a wall of defensive measures on the hill above camp. 80 volunteers assisted camp employees over 6 different weekends to fill and place 10,000 sandbags. That's a lot of sandbags. We are so grateful for their labor of love. We hired an erosion control company to install 700 bales of straw from one end of camp to the other and erect 1,500 linear feet of silk curtains, all designed to redirect water and mud flow away from our structures. In the photos, you will see the gray K-rails, the double-wide straw wall, and the black silk curtains. To date, we have spent $70,000 on erosion control measures, including geology and surveying costs. The sandbags, straw walls, and silk curtains are all temporary measures. It is estimated that permanent water diversion measures will cost upwards of $500,000. But for now, we are concentrating on immediate priorities. The first priority is to raise enough money to meet monthly fixed costs while we are closed. The second is to raise the $70,000 to cover the costs of the erosion mitigation efforts. Our 2021 fundraising goal will be upwards of $350,000 so the camp can cover its fixed costs for many months to come. Your continued help through special collections and recurring giving will be key to de Benneville's survival going forward. As we move into 2021, Camp's 60th anniversary year, I want to personally thank you for your outpouring of love and financial support thus far, and my deep gratitude for your assistance going forward. Although the challenges seem overwhelming, I know we can meet them together and once again celebrate in community up on the mountaintop. Stay well, everyone.
Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side. Draw the circle, draw the circle.
the circle wide.
Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide.
No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side.
Our prayer is Each Breath by Leif Siegelman. We pause in the stillness to rest for a moment, to quiet ourselves so that we can feel what stirs within us. Each breath draws us closer to the pulse of life, and with each exhalation, we make room for something new. May we encounter patience along our growing edges and compassion in our most tender spots. Here, may we find the inspiration and encouragement we need to face our challenges and to nurture ourselves. And in the presence of suffering across the globe, may we redouble our efforts to practice kindness where we are, with the hope that the light of our actions travels like the light of faraway stars. May our gestures of compassion and generosity, may they seed possibility. May we walk humbly with one another, choosing reconciliation over resentment as we try to live right-sized. When life presses in and shifts us off balance, when pain assails us, when frustration mounts, may the rhythm of our breath steady us and bring us back to a place of gratitude and love. May it be so, and amen.
Let us join together now as we extinguish the flame of our chalice and say these words together. We extinguish our chalice, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Thank you everyone for joining us this morning. Wow, what a wonderful, wonderful service on revolutionary love. And before we go this morning, I want to draw your attention to some other wonderful, huge gatherings out there that you can be involved in. If you like big UU gatherings, this is where it's at. So I want to point out that this Saturday, we've got our Pacific Western Region Assemblies, Love Right Through. Should be a wonderful, wonderful, I think it's just a half a day from noon to five. They're going to have some wonderful workshops and everything. So please check them out on their website. New Day Rising Conference on Multicultural Transformation is on Saturday, February 27th. Please join me there. It looks like it's going to be absolutely amazing. And then, of course, you've got General Assembly. This happens in June. And for those of you who might be new, it is a national, all UUs around and even around the world come to this, and it's going to be on Zoom. So if you've ever been like, oh, I can't afford to fly out there, hey, it's on Zoom. Everybody can be there. So come and sign up for those. You see the information there. If you just go out to the eventheuua.org website, you can find information about all of these things. So I also just want to say, if you're a guest or a visitor, we hope you enjoyed this special service, and feel free to write your name in the chat, maybe where you're from. We want everyone to feel part of the beloved community. So please reach out to the church nearest you and they will help you get connected. And just a reminder, after the benediction, we will have a short period where everyone can sort of wave and say hello. And then those that remain, wish to, can be put into Zoom breakout rooms for 20 minutes. You don't need a different link. You don't need to go anywhere. We're going to do it right here. So we invite you then to introduce yourself and get to know some new people. So as we go, let us sing together. Let's join Carol in singing a wonderful benediction. Thank you. the circle wide, people. Let's draw it wider still. This is how we create a revolutionary love. This service is over. Let our service continue.